Greetings. Welcome to the studio. Delighted to have you here. Thank you so much for being here. It's wonderful to see you here. For those of you that are new, it would be great if you could just send us, tell us where you're actually logging in from, where you're viewing the program. That would be fantastic. It's nice to actually know that people are coming from all over the world. Some local, right down the road from us, some from the US, Europe, and further afield as well. So do send us a text. Tell us where you're coming from, where you're actually viewing this from. That would be fantastic. Okay, this evening I'm delighted to introduce Anne-Laure GUERET, a French photographer based in Accra, the capital of Ghana. She's an incredible photographer, does a lot of candid street photography, as well as landscapes, and has a very, very interesting way of working, which we'll be discussing as we go along. But before we actually introduce Anne, let me make a couple of announcements. we've got something. We've got Ingrid, hello from Sweden. Well, hello, Ingrid. Thank you for being here. All the way from Sweden. That's fantastic. Good to see you again. Thank you so much. So, others, folks, do... by the way, I do strongly suggest that if you can, do log in to your Facebook or YouTube account. This way, you can actually interact. Otherwise, it makes it far more interesting for us, and you get a lot more. Both Anne, I'm speaking for her now, but I'm absolutely certain that she'll agree with me, both Anne, or Anne-Laure, and myself are really keen to share our expertise, our knowledge, right? So that's why we're here. This is one of the key things about In Conversation, is about sharing knowledge and experience. So do log in, that way you can actually converse with us and participate. That makes it far more interesting for you, but also for us. So, before I introduce Anne-Laure, I'll just make a couple of announcements. These are regarding Diorama Days, the company that I run, offering landscape photography workshops, bespoke workshops across Cornwall and Devon. We have a number of workshops, but the ones that would really be interesting, at the ones that I would really wanted to talk to you about, are the workshops across Cornwall and Devon. So yeah, so keep an eye on those. Go to the website, that'll be fine. I also offer a number of holiday courses, which I'm sure might interest you as well. So yeah, so those as well are very, very interesting as well. Also, we have a number in the workshops page. You'll actually see that we have a number of a number of workshops that are dedicated to photography and archaeology. Now, these are really cool. We take a multidisciplinary approach. Carolyn Kennett, she is an astronomer, an archaeoastronomer with an incredibly sound knowledge of archaeology in the region, in Cornwall. So we're giving joint workshops and we have a number of days across the year. So those are really, really interesting and cool. Okay, without further ado, folks. We have somebody else. Lucia. Hi, Harry. Finally, I made it. Excellent. Thank you so much for being here. I remember your name. I'm not quite from Instagram, as a matter of fact, but I'm not quite sure where you're based. I think it might be Italy. And it's wonderful to have you here. Lucia, thank you so much for being here. It's great. Cool. Folks, without further ado, let me introduce you to Anne-Laure. Hello there. How are you?
Hello, Harry. I'm good, thank you.
Excellent. Great to see you. Oops, great, I just lost you. Fantastic. Let me introduce you there. We had a little technical glitch. Good. So, yeah, so this is a great opportunity to actually talk about your work. I discovered Anne-Laure through Instagram, as a matter of fact, as one does. And this is how we started a conversation. This is how we started a dialogue. And about a month ago, and it's taken us that long to actually prepare and get this ready off the ground, and here we are. So yeah, yeah, it's great.
Yeah, you made me work.
Yeah, typical. That's great. So tell us, a little bit about your photography and a little bit of your photography background,
yeah,
before we start having a look at the actual images and way
no
in
problem.
Which you work.
No problem. I mean, I started quite late photography, and it was on my first trip to Africa in Senegal when I moved in 2010 that I realized there was really something different in terms of, you know, ambiance, lightings, atmospheres. At that time, you know, I just left my job back in cinema in Paris, moved with my husband in Senegal. And after a few years' time, I started practicing, but it was really, non-professionally talking. It was, you know, really like I had like a really small camera, and I was just practicing, actually. I think I was getting my eyes ready. Mm-hmm. But then we moved to South Africa, and that's where like I decided to take a step further in my practice. And I took a program for like 6 months in a company called like CODP, like it's like a course in digital photography. And you know, that was a sort of a mind-blowing experience, because I really realized that I could connect my ideas, my visions, you know, into a proper image. And so yeah, that's when actually I really started to really get into photography and practicing it.
Yep.
You know, on a regular basis. And after, it was like a long trip to actually find like what was my style, like what was I good at shooting, because I learned the basics in terms of technical aspects. But then it's about like shooting and getting your exposure right, getting your frame and your composition right. But you know, sometimes it doesn't really, there's no really like emotion behind the images. So that's the second part of your job when you learn photography, is like to put yourself into the photography and tell a bit about something, like tell something a little bit about yourself. I mean, that's what photography is for me, is showing something, but also putting, to seed something about, you know, to seed something about yourself in it. So
absolutely.
And
yes,
it was a long trip of like, probably like 10 years, and I'm still thinking or believing that I'm still learning today. So
yes. I think that's where the passion comes, and I think that's that constant learning. It's ongoing learning. It never ends, really, and it always moves on. Like somebody once said, "What's your best photograph? The next one." So,
yeah.
And I think
exactly.
It's like that. Yeah, exactly. And I think it may have been Diane Arbus, I'm not sure. But
Oh, yeah. I think we had that chat last
time. We did have that chat, definitely. So, yeah, I think this is where it's at. And street photography, that's quite a skill, because you need to be fast. You need to actually set up situations, see them coming, see opportunity wherever it is, and seize it and go with the flow, go with the moment.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that, how you started with street photography.
I mean, I think the combination of my love for being very social, being very curious and passionate about people in the first place, I think that's what drove me into street or documentary photography. Because I mean, I really admire like fashion photographer or people who works for commission works. What I like is the freedom of the streets, the freedom of people. This moment that, you know, like just flings and just pass by through in front of your eyes. And that's how I understood that was my thing, because it was how would you say, yeah, it was a correlation with my own character, with my own personality. And first I was very shy in the streets, especially in Johannesburg, you know, like you're not really supposed to go anywhere, but me, I was very adventurous. So sometimes I was going off track and people were like, no, you shouldn't go there. You know, you have a camera and everything, like, but despite this, sometimes I was taking a bit of liberty, and that's where you get, you know, the most interesting things. So that's a bit how I started, and that's where I find, you know, the most joy and the most excitement. You know, I'm not really a technical person.
Mm-hmm.
I'm more human oriented. So what I like is discuss with my subject, meet them, have a chat, know what they're doing, if they're doing something, or if there's something funny about their, I don't know, costume, attitude or anything. Like I usually try to have to have a chat, but because first of all, before the image, it's the human that I'm interested in. So that's usually the field conductor, as you say, like the conductor.
Yeah, the conductor. Yes, absolutely. The starting point of how you actually, absolutely. It's seeing that opportunity and actually identifying where you feel comfortable at. And you're absolutely right
about feel comfortable. Otherwise, I believe that it will reflect in the photograph. Like,
yes,
because you're not going to be comfortable framing it. The frame and the composition is going to be a bit skewed. Or if you're comfortable and the person in front of you is comfortable, well, that's where you can create magic and really create something within the image. So
yes, I couldn't agree more. And I think also what you were saying earlier, this idea of gently pushing yourself, pushing the envelope, always pushing the envelope, seeing how far you can actually get away, always being sure that you're safe. Always, I think that's primordial.
Yeah. But always any slap or any punch in the face.
Yeah, well, that's good. Excellent. Listen, how about we start having a look at some of your images? Shall we kick off with that? Brilliant.
Go ahead.
Wonderful. Here we are.
So yeah, that was my introduction.
Cool.
The presentation. But yeah, so that's the first image you're going to see. So that's Deirdre. I call her gracious because the way she's standing there and leaning towards me and with the wind flowing, you know, through her like, you know, like kids on those, that was on the western coast of Ghana. And we were having, you know, a family trip, actually, and I always carry my camera and I always stop everywhere, speak with everyone. That makes my family very annoyed with me. But yeah, she was coming around us. She was very curious. She was playing with my daughter. And at some point, I decided to, you know, to aim for the picture because I thought her face was, you know, very unique. Like girls here get their hair shaved when they go to school, so that allows you, you know, to see, you know, to get rid of everything, and you just have the pure, like the pureness, pureness. I'm not too sure.
Yeah, the pureness is fine. Yeah, yeah.
The pureness of the face, and obviously that was a bit of an overcast day, and she just like leaned towards me, and I just, you know, shot and. I like the attitude of the girl with her crossed arm, and obviously that's a bit of a editing work on the color tones to make it a bit more vintagey. I mean, those kids wears most of them like secondhand clothes coming from Europe, and sometimes that's how you end up with like very vintagey sort of dresses. Once I saw a little boy with like a Donald Trump t-shirt, like for supporters. And I was like, do you know who is Donald Trump? And the boy like didn't know. I mean, it's not part of the selection, but I did shot a little boy with the Donald Trump t-shirt too. So I don't know, like it gives a little like vintagey sort of look to the portrait.
Absolutely. Yes. And I think it's that issue of also, it's not just the I think all this is really interesting, and what you're actually mentioning, because it all is part of the process of not just producing, but also the post-production as well, and the selection, the choice of that look, that style, that design, so that then that fits within your portfolio ultimately. Mm-hmm. And I think that comes through in your Instagram. There's a very deliberate choice of colors. There's a theme, almost like an in-house theme that that gives that image or the series of images your style. Cool. Shall we move to the next?
Should we? Yes, shall we? Okay, so that's my portrait of a young lady. I mean, first I was not like completely happy about my picture. I mean, I was on a trip with a friend of mine. Like, she works for fish farms, and she was taking me on trip to visit the fish farm to take pictures in order to produce photograph for her company. And she was, I mean, I was taking pictures all around, but I noticed her like with the thing in her hair,
just the veil, you know.
Yeah, the veil. Mm-hmm. And she was not really part of the scene, but I noticed her, you know, on the side of my eyes. Like, I noticed her, she has a very interesting face, and like she's very, you know, very thin and very gracious also in a way. After taking the photographs I was sort of like commissioned for, I decided to go for my own sort of private shot. And yeah, that's where like she was just standing there leaning her head to this wooden thing. Mm-hmm. And when I turned into black, I realized this photograph is a bit intemporal. Like, you couldn't really say, is it Ghana from the 60s, 70s, or nowadays, you know? She has this intemporal look, I'm not sure you can really see, but technically the picture is not perfect because I was a bit, I mean, doing it in the middle of two things. But also the fact that it's technically not perfect make it look also, you know, quite unique in a way. And I was not too sure at the beginning, but the more I see it and the more I actually like it. And the fact that like there's this very bright color on her neck and the shape of her back, I mean, there's the whole attitude to this girl that I really like. I mean, I don't know what you think, guys, but
I would agree with you. I would definitely agree with you there, Anne-Laure, in every point. One, I think it's I think black and white kind of gives it a timelessness. It looks a lot. It always appears to be a lot earlier than what it actually is. I think the moment you have colors, you know that it's not, you can almost date a color image by the kind of color you have, 70s, 60s, 50s, and more modern as well. Also, I think in this image, because it's what's called in painting, as a matter of fact, it's called a chiaro oscuro, the mm-hmm. light and dark in Italian. And that's a technique that's as old as painting. I think already in the Renaissance they were using that sort of technique, which you actually use very well here. So the areas of the highlights are almost bleached out, not quite bleached out. The areas of shadows, you've got shadows with details, and that works beautifully. You have this wooden plank, which and that texture also comes out. So yeah, it works really nicely. And you also have that kind of the framing that is very much along the rule of thirds or the golden mean, which always works. So cool. Shall we move to
It's funny because I never think about these things when I mean, you know, I just shoot the picture the way I'm like feeling it. But I don't see all these things actually. I mean, it's really nice also to have this conversation because it makes me realize also a lot of things.
I think but I think that's the beauty of photography. I mean, these are the random things. I mean, I do landscapes and I keep getting random things. And I think once you kind of get into that kind of groove, I think you attract it. And you know, it's stuff that I never saw at the time of photographing. These are small details, but often it's those small details that make, you know, the photograph. It's what Roland Barthes, the famous French sociologist, author, and keen photographer, wrote in Camera Obscura.
The punct. I will check that.
Yeah. Check it out. The punctum. The punctum, okay. Which is this small element within a photograph that all of a sudden can draw your attention. In this case, the punctum is the subject is the female in the foreground, but I would say that the punctum is the male in the background. And always my eyes go first to her, they scan her, then it goes there and back. It's almost like playing a little ping pong. But in this case, that's the punctum. And I think it's these random elements that come into the photograph that make it interesting. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, I'm trying to look at it like cutting the guy out, but because I mean I'm not gonna lie, I didn't intentionally put him inside. I was so focused to her and her face and everything. But I think it's like those sort of like happy mistake that you unconsciously create when you get more confident with your scenes, with your subjects and everything. So.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. Let's move on to the next.
Yes.
Oh, sorry, I did two there, my mistake.
Too fast.
Yeah, too fast.
Well, same. This is on the shore of the Volta Lake. We were having a walk with some friends, and we passed by like a little like pass going downwards, and I noticed on the first way in these boats on the back, and like this form of like forming like a tunnel through the greens, and then I said, "Okay, wait for me 1 second. I'm coming back." So I had to investigate. That's why, like, you have to, to go out of your comfort zone and just trust your instincts and your guts. I had to go and see for myself, and I felt it right. Like, always believe, I think, your instincts. To me, maybe it's only to me, but yeah, I really saw something with the reflection into the boats, because they were like full of water, and the shapes created by the greens and the boats with the shore on the other side. There was something a bit, magical, mystical, I'm not too sure, but a bit like in a movie, you want to get into the boat, and you want to sail on the other shore, on the other side of the shore. So that what drew my attention, and so I took a various frames, a bit with playing with the focals, but I actually like it. I like the boat being the center frame with the vegetation in this really small, like sort of pinhole, lights you see in the middle.
Absolutely. Absolutely. No, it's a lovely photograph. This idea, again, it's the classic approach, the frame within a frame, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So the water, the land, the kind of semicircular bit of coast where the water's edge, and then the vegetation that in itself makes a beautiful irregular frame, and then there's the light. And there's the background. And then something that you mentioned earlier, trusting your instinct. I think that is so, so important. I think that, in my opinion, it's the only thing you can really trust. If you see it and it's somehow, you're somehow moved by it, go for it.
What's the risk, where worst case scenario, you're going to have an empty shot,
Yeah.
But I mean, that's really my process is like, and the more and more I do photography, this is like, trusting yourself, trusting your instinct is, I think is the base in order to find your style. Otherwise you're just copying. It's good to practice in terms of like techniques. But finding your style is something, it's like inner, it's an inner thing. So
yes.
If you don't follow your guts, who's gonna follow you?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think you're so right. It's actually, there's one side of photography that is the technical side, which is all very well. But I think in a way we need to go, in my opinion, it's about going beyond the technical, and it's about connecting at an emotional level. And I think this is where certainly with my work to this day, I still strive to actually connect with the landscapes. How can I actually make some sort of resonance at an emotional level? It's about feeling an emotion that in a way conveys something that is beyond words, in a way.
And there's nobody, I mean, nobody can really teach you that apart from you.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, yeah, and they say.
There's no proper books, you know, to learn, oh, who am I? How do I feel? Like, what makes me feel happy when I take a photograph? Like, there's no book for that, you know?
Absolutely. Again, it's something that gets an old saying, like, Cartier-Bresson said, I think he said, like, the first 10, your first 10,000 photographs are rubbish.
Yeah, exactly. I thought about that quote, like, not so long ago, actually. I was like, how many frame am I at like now? Maybe close to 10,000. So maybe, you know,
something
I
like
can
that.
Only get better.
Let's move on.
Yeah.
Ah.
All right. So there, that's my.
I'm just going to interrupt you for one moment, folks. Send us your comments and questions as we go along. Don't wait until the end. If you have anything, if you'd like to say anything, just do it. Act by go with your instinct, I say, and.
Yes.
Absolutely, and we'll actually weave it into our conversation. As you've seen, this is an unscripted chat that we're actually having about the photographs, which is the beauty of it. And join in the conversation, please. If you haven't logged in, if you log into your YouTube account or your Facebook account, you should be able to actually use the comments and questions. Okay, sorry about that, Anne-Laure.
No worries.
Over to
no
you.
No problem. I'm still here.
Excellent.
Hopefully. but this is, I mean, I'm not going to say, this is in Ghana. Obviously, all the pictures have been taken in Ghana. There was a walk I was taking in the city center, like called Jamestown, so that the historical part. And yeah, I was just drawn, I mean, those ladies carrying their kids, having to play with balance, where like holding heavy trays or buckets of water or everything. For me, they're like real modern heroes, because who in Europe could say that they could, you know, deal with that? And she was like still smiling, and I was just like getting to her, because I always try to approach, you know, people. So I approached the girl, the baby girl, and she was like very strong in the way of looking at me. And yeah, I just asked, okay, do you mind? May I take a photograph? And, you know, in this, crumbling buildings, because in Jamestown, there's a lot of like old colonial buildings, you know, falling apart.
Yeah.
And she's standing there strong, you know, carrying her kids on the back and holding her tray of avocados. She's in a really strong position with turns, you know, from her skirt, top, the clothes, like she has the kids holding with. It was just appearing to me like she was looking very strong, and same, I mean, not that I'm a vintage fan, but yeah, I treated a bit the color tone in a vintage sort of look, you know. It was a bit brighter and more saturated, and I deliberately chose to desaturate it and uncontrast it a little bit. But that's the story behind it.
Excellent. That's interesting. Yes, and the beautiful toddler. I think it's really interesting how your approach of asking people, and that, because it's about being concerned and having respect for that private space, that respect for the individual, not taking things for granted, not rubbing people up the wrong way, because then you can get feedback.
Especially because obviously, you know, I'm a European living in an African country, and I think there's no other way to fit into it. Like, if you arrive and starting taking pictures like this without asking for permission, it's first of all ethically very bad, and I think at the end, I mean, photograph won't be good, and you know. But what makes so interesting to live here is the happiness and everything. So people have to be happy to be in your photographs.
Yes, and I think that's a philosophy. That's a very good philosophy, and I think it's one particular way of working, which I think is great. I commend it. Mm-hmm. We've got a couple of comments. Let me pull them over. From Lucia, I'm enjoying a lot. I lived in Ghana for several years, and it's nice to have a kind of flashback. Excellent. Thank you, Lucia.
There's a couple. Did you live in Accra? I mean, can I reply?
Yeah. Did you live in Accra? Tell us more. Ghanaians are very fashionable and proud. They like pics. Yes. Absolutely. Mm-hmm, yes.
Yeah, especially kids. Kids love it, and they always go like, you have to say when you want to take a picture. Sometimes with kids, when they agree, say no, don't do those signs. Like, you know, just do your things. Yeah, they really want to be in, but they also like to take pictures of you. You know, in some regions, because I mean, sounds weird, but yeah, they don't get to see a lot of Obroni faces, so yeah, sometimes you take a photograph, but you have also to be in their photograph, which
absolutely, it's reciprocated.
I never say no because you know, it's fun.
Absolutely, it in a way it addresses the power relationship of the photographer, and Laure has a good eye.
Thank you, Lucia.
Lucia, thank you for your comments. That's great. So cool. Shall we move on?
Sure.
Aha, okay. Yes.
Uh-huh. That's Richard. You know, like that. That's one of these boys. But he's, I was visiting, you know, like a center where it's like an NGO where they learn girls how to sew. And it's in a complex. And this kid was playing basketball. And I noticed him. And he said, oh, but I want to be a boxer. You know, I want to be a boxer, because it was just around the time, I think, a Ghanaian boxer won like a medal or a gold medal. I don't remember. I mean, I'm not good at boxing at all, but a Ghanaian just won a medal on a championship. And so he was like all excited. And I said, oh, yeah, show me your moves. And he's starting like, yeah, to dance around me with punching and uppercuts and everything. And at some point, I mean, this is the one I put in the selection,
the edit. Yes.
I also played sometimes on like overlapping and creating double exposure, so it looks like he's like actually dancing all around me with like boom bam boom.
Yep.
And but I like this one because same, like he looks and I was very surprised, like Richard was like a 13-year-old kid, but you could tell like he knew how to box, and he was very strong, and he knew what he was doing. So
cool.
I was like, yeah, wish you luck. But yeah, he's very strong and firm word, but yeah, he was looking very strong and super happy to make me a little demo of boxing. So.
Excellent. Yes, there's a determined.
I took advantage of the situation.
Yeah. No. Absolutely. It's, you play with, you go with your strength, and you seize the opportunity. Lucia, yes, in airport, residential area.
Okay, that's where I am. Okay.
Here we have a landscape. Cool.
Yes. Well, this one is on the other side, like eastern coast towards, I mean, you have Ada, and after you carry on towards the Togo border. And same, we were like just having a trip, a family trip. And I noticed these boats on the top of the hills and of the beach, and obviously behind there there's the ocean. But what I liked playing with was, you know, a bit inversing. It's a bit like the ocean, like a green ocean, and with just this single pink flower standing. I mean, she's obviously the main for me, the main interest. Without it, it would, picture wouldn't work the same way, I believe.
Yes, yes, you're right.
And it's a bit like, yeah, the boats are, yeah, just floating, you know, on the greens and the sand. So yeah, it's a bit poetic. I mean, to me, that's how I saw it. That's how I saw it. Like, it's a bit like reversing. Like, you could switch the sky, the blue sky, and put, you know, put the blue sky on the greens, and you would say, oh, the boats are floating on the water, but they are not. So
absolutely, yes, yes, the idea of metaphor and symbolism. Yes. And yes, definitely. Cool. I'll move on.
Yes, well, saying like typical sort of like beach scenes, with like those two boys like running the two boats, and the wreck ship on the background. So yeah, there's a bit like a form of like layering here. And yeah, I like that the boy, like he's just like, it's like he's waving, you know, for a ride or something with the, you know, the wreck boat. I mean, there's a whole messed up situation here. And I mean, I think if I do recall, when I was aiming at the boat, I mean, mm-hmm. I noticed on the side of my eye that those kids were arriving. So I you know, I said, okay, don't move. Let them, you know, like, let them cross the frame and then click at that moment. So that's how it happened. The whole,
excellent.
Yeah, I first like having a look of my surroundings. I noticed the book, I noticed the wreck. I said, okay, we are missing something here, but yeah, let's wait a little bit. So you frame, and yeah, I noticed the kids were coming, and that's it.
Exactly. So many times it's about waiting for the right moment.
Yeah.
And in a way seeing what's, or almost being able to tell what's going to happen next as they come into frame. And also I think it's the second boy on the right, and I think it's the movement.
Yeah, yes, the movement.
The arms, the hands,
wait
and
for
the, yeah, exactly. Cool. Move on to the next.
Mm-hmm. That's, yeah, Bojo Beach. Maybe, is it Julia, right?
Lucia.
Lucia, sorry. Lucia, yeah, maybe you're reminding Bojo Beach. But yeah, I was actually helping a friend who was doing a photo shoot there with horses. And we stayed a bit on the beach, and it was sunset time. I mean, obviously, I don't have to say too much. But yeah, it's just the silhouettes with the sunset, and I don't really think there's much edit on that.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, yeah, the happy child. I mean, Ghanaians love their beaches. They love to spend their weekend there, and yeah, it's just, yeah, what's happening here? People are happy. It's, you know, it's a hot sunny sunset day, and yeah, I like the beach, and I like sunsets, like I think everybody. But yeah, this one is a bit busier, I will say, and I like it this way, actually.
Yes, it's the silhouettes against that mist, that sort of mist that's almost like a mist that's coming in the background. Here we have a comment from Ingrid. Stunning and a feeling of worship. Yes.
Thank you.
Excellent. Yes, definitely. Thank you, Ingrid. That's cool.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Ingrid. You're from Sweden.
Yeah.
I mean, this is also from Jamestown. You had a fisherman community there. Well, they live in extreme poverty, and I mean, nobody really cares. I mean, I was really shocked the first time I came there, but it's also the skill they have to fix the nets. This is their only way of, you know, surviving, and everything is, you know, the fishing, but they really live in a really, really, really poor condition. And I like sometimes like close up, and you know, it expressed the best in black and white, obviously. Those hands, you know, busy working on the nets, those, you know, like they're dirty, they're wrinkled. So, you know, it gives a bit of a dramatic sort of feel.
Absolutely. Yeah. Hands are so expressive. They can actually tell us so much, so much.
Yeah. It's very contextual. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, obviously, you know, it's a fishnet. You have, you know, the whole thing, but yeah.
Absolutely. And the tools of the trade.
And the tools. Yeah. But it's just because I remember that man and the environment he was living in. So I have a bit of more context than you. That makes maybe the photograph a bit more special to me. But yeah,
quite.
It speaks for itself.
Oh, we have a comment here from Ingrid. The woman with her arms out in the middle, just love it. Oh, that must be from an earlier image. Let me go back one.
Is it the first one?
I'm not quite sure which one that is. Maybe you could tell us a little bit more, Ingrid.
Yeah, I would think it's the girl who is leaning towards the frame, like she's crossing her arm.
Yes, the very first.
The very first one.
Oh yeah, no, it's this one here. No, it's this one here. Yes, it must have been one of these characters here with the arms there. Yes.
Yeah.
Cool. Excellent. Yep, we got it.
Yes.
Excellent. Yes. Cool. Uh-huh. Thank you, Ingrid. Okay, moving on.
Yep.
Aha.
Uh-huh. That's, yeah, Cape Coast, just outside the castle. Same, you have the fishermen community. And funny enough, I mean, I was attracted by that French flag, very chauvinistic. But I mean, I'm not too sure what is the flag in the foreground. I've been trying to identify it, but yeah, it's the whole surroundings. It's so busy. These guy leanings, all the nets. Obviously, it's a bit wide angle. But yeah, what got my attention? What the French flag? What is it doing here?
yes.
Yeah, especially in a place like the Cape Coast Castle. You know, the old like slave forts back in the days. So yeah, the scene on my back is quite dramatic. But yeah, I mean all those bows next to each other, the waves, you know, shocking on the shore.
Absolutely, and
the flags.
Yes, you're right, and it's those flags, and the one in the foreground, it looks like kind of designer a sort of designer fabric, doesn't it? That's been kind of recontextualized. It could have been, I don't know, a duvet cover or something that's been recontextualized and it's become a marker. And we've got a comment from Jen, referring to the earlier photograph of the hands, the skills of the hands, beautiful capture. Thank you, Jen.
That's great.
Indeed.
And I think behind, I misplaced it because there was another one, but you'll get back to it. I mean, obviously this one, everybody knows.
Yes.
We've all been through it. And yes. I was seeing that guy every week going to the supermarket, like aiming at you with his like temperature gun. And
yeah.
I was seeing it, oh man, I have to get that shot because it reminded me of a picture of, he's a French artist called GUERET. I don't know if anybody knows about him, but
he
used the same sort of like direct frame.
Yeah.
But the guy is shooting with a camera, so he's like looking at people like he's holding a gun, but he's shooting with a camera, and I love this.
Could you spell their name for us, please?
It's J R. Let me find. Maybe I can like quickly find the picture for you. Yes, that's this one. I don't know if anybody will see it, but...
Yes, if you hold it up, we'll probably be able to make it.
Wait. Okay.
Oh, yes.
You see?
Aha, uh-huh. Yes.
And that's what I was seeing when I saw this guy. It's just funny enough, he was holding this temperature gun and he was the security guy at the supermarket. And one day, I say, okay... Can I take a picture? Because there's a bit of cynical humor there, maybe.
Yes, but it also is indicative of sign of the times, isn't it? It's almost it's become a universal picture sort of thing. You know, the ubiquitous security guard with a temperature measuring device, you know, from the Apple store in Plymouth shopping center to Accra, you know. So
And Ghana has been a really, really good student, you know, like things have been pretty smooth here. So they were everywhere, these guys shooting you all the time.
Yeah,
everywhere.
Absolutely. Let me just go back one and recover, because we have a comment from Jen. Mm-hmm. Captivating colors. Yes, absolutely. And I think this is what actually does it, isn't it? It's the greens, the fluttering flags and you know, brilliant primary colors, their greens, reds, blues, yellows, and so on, and against the rather kind of pastel background. So yes, it's that actually brings it out. And the beautifully lit boats, stunning boats, by the way. And we have a comment from Joe Black. Hello, very beautiful pictures, real life moments. That's a really good comment, Joe. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Joe.
Moving on. Aha. Uh-huh.
Yeah, the beauty salons. Next to my previous house flat. And same, you know, I passed by there quite often. I think I was going to buy like credits, because here, like, you buy credits in the streets and everything. And I saw this lady with her, I don't know, how do you call the thing she has in her hair?
I've got a blank.
do you use
roller, rollers? No, I don't use them. rollers? I think it's called rollers. But forgive me. Yeah. Anyway.
Everybody
we know what you mean. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. And I was, ladies. I mean, in Ghana, they love their the the beauty salons and the hair salons. I mean, you know how African ladies do their hair all the time. I mean, I'm quite jealous because I can't do anything with my hair. But yeah, she was standing there. I don't know what she was looking for. And I think I didn't ask, but I showed her the picture afterwards and asked her if she was, you know, happy with it. I mean, if people say no, I mean, you can't, you know, share it on socials, or you can have it. I'm happy to delete it. But if I would have called her, it would have kind of ruined the candid sort of feel. You know, she's looking on the ground, like she's natural. She's not posing or anything.
Exactly. Curlers. Thank you. Thank you, Ingrid. That's it. Yes, we had a moment there. Faux pas. Thank you. Cool. Yeah. Moving on. This is an interesting one.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny, you know, like sometimes, I mean, I like this photograph because I remember I was in a sort of like little place near Kokrobite. It was like a little, not like a lodge, but it's like a little place where they have, like, you can camp and everything. And that were like the housekeeping lady. I always tend to go, you know, behind what lays, you know, in front of my eyes. So I always go for what's behind, like trying to find the hidden tracks. And yeah, she was there washing, you know, the laundry from the camping and from the lodge. And I saw all these sheets hanging with all the colors and the buckets. The whole thing was just like, wow, there's so many things going on here. And she saw me with the camera and everything. I just, like, you know, lift the camera, like, as a way of asking, like, oh, do you mind me taking a picture? And she was like, she was happy. I think she, you know, like, she was happy somebody was coming to her, making that step forward, and, you know, getting interested in what she was doing. So
yeah.
I mean, in a way, I mean, there's only respect, and I mean, you can tell, like, she's been working super hard with the guy behind, like, who is, you know, busy putting everything on the string.
Washing line. Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think it's that also. I think what interests me, what really caught my eye, was your interaction with people, how you interact. And I think that is about collaboration and striking a kind of relationship, and also a relationship of trust in a fraction of a second and in moments there. And actually, yes, you can take my photographs, it's fine. And they're so relaxed. And I think that is what caught my eye about your practice, is that ability
you
to
don't arrive like you're winning the space. You're arriving into somebody else's space. And you arrive on your tippy toes with a smile and, you know, show a bit of interest. And I mean, obviously, I mean, I don't fake it. If I go to the scenes because I've seen something, you know, very egoistically, but yeah, I've seen something that, you know, caught my eyes. But yeah, there's a lot of respect in the process.
Yes, no, absolutely. I think you're absolutely right, and it's this thing of honesty and being sincere, not lying to people. And I think this is a way of gaining trust. Even I do it in my landscape photographs. I often have to deal with farmers because I'm often actually going onto land that is owned by something. It's not just kind of, you can't just want to walk along, and it's their livelihood, you know, their farm, their animals, the produce, and so on and so forth. So I'm very respectful, and I always I'm very upfront. I tell people what I'm doing, and then I got them on my side, and then they remember me. And if I go back, which I often do, it's just a wave. Yeah, oh, by the way, and everything's fine. It's that ice-breaking moment, and it's that trust. So I think it's so important. It's your advice is so good. And law that's the way it's done. So yeah, moving on to the next.
Yeah.
Aha, this is an interesting one.
Yeah. I don't recall the name of the lady, but I was obviously and she had those you know, marks on her face, like actually symmetrical. She has the same, and yeah, I was like, first, okay. I mean, she was selling seashells on the seashore.
Okay.
You know this phrase?
Yes, the tongue twister.
Yes. And yeah, I mean, I'm interested. Like, she has beautiful seashells and everything, but I'm more interested into her face, obviously. Mm-hmm. And yeah, ask her. I mean, this is beauty signs in Ghana. Like, they mark the scarifications. Like, they do scarification on the face when you're kind of a baby, and it's like a beauty mark for them. And it's, I mean, it sounds a bit crazy to us, but it looks like a bit like a flower or sun rays, or she was like so proud of holding, you know, having this, you know, scar on her face that I asked her, oh wow, do you mind, you know, like she could have been, I mean, I was a bit embarrassed to ask this, because you never know how it could be actually taken, but I ask. I always like kind of ask. You know,
yeah, no, absolutely right.
In a very low profile kind of like, oh, can I take a picture? Like, oh, this is funny. You have marks. No, we have the chat. We exchange. She kind of give me up some insights about these marks.
Mm-hmm.
And she accepted. I mean, what I always, I mean, I never give money for picture. Also, this is important, because a lot of people sometimes ask you, say, okay, but yeah, you're gonna have to give me money. And I say, no, I don't give, you know, it's ruining it, you know, it's kind of ruining the whole spontaneity and the whole process of getting a photograph, you know.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, that, you have a question here. Joe Black, natural scars? No, they're actually called scarification. They're actually scars that are decorative scars, markings that are actually often have a magical or some sort of associative magic or symbolism within the culture. It means something that is powerful. It's very much another way of body modification, just like we use here with tattoos and different types of body modifications. It's old as humanity itself.
So
they vary an awful lot. Also, I think it's that idea of one asking, and also getting, because you're really up close here. You're really, really close, and it's that intimacy and being able to actually get up close. That's a great skill. I admire that.
Thanks.
We're going slightly over the hour, folks, but I hope you don't mind. We're going a bit slower than planned, but we're going into a lot of detail into each one. So we'll carry on.
Okay. The two next one, it's going to be the same context. It's just different girls. So this is Dede Stella and Vera. Dede Stella is the girl in the blue, like kind of fairy dresses. And Vera is the yellow girl. I was actually helping a friend who, during the pandemic, like these street kids, the school were closed, and she was organizing workshops, like art workshops. And I was just giving a hand, and these two girls were like so trying to connect with, you know, the foreigners, and you know, they were the more extroverts ones, and. And I don't know, at some point they were standing close from, or did I ask them? I mean, I don't want to say lies. I don't remember if I asked them to pose there or if they were standing there. But just like the whole color patterns, and they were very strong-willed, you know, like they were very, very unique girls. And all the kids were like super nice, but these two in particular were very fearless and very strong. So for couple times I was going on the camp helping, and I was bonding with these two girls, because even though, I mean, they barely spoke English, obviously no French, and I can't really speak Twi yet. We had a great connection, and they enjoyed a lot photograph, but yeah.
Absolutely, and I think what is striking in this, for me at least, is yes, there's the colours, definitely, there's the pose, but also is the gaze, how the gaze, their gaze is direct, looks back at into the camera, into the lens, at the photographer, at the audience, and I think that is what really kind of, in my mind, that is what really brings it to life, what makes it, separates it from something else. Moving on. Ah, yes.
And this one is the same. These two girls was like called Mama and Charitable. That was like the lunch. I mean, my friend was providing for them every lunch. So a girl was cooking, and I mean, these two little girls, same, like in those fantastic white outfits. They were standing on a little like sort of hill, and there's a bit of like wide angle. And I don't know, I mean, the fact that one is like turned to like front, and the other one is like slightly standing in profile.
Yes.
I don't know, makes it, I mean, to me, a very nice portrait. And I love the little girl's dress. I mean, I love the
It is sweet, definitely. Yes, I think it gives it that candid, unposed, natural sort of look. And both of them, I think, are in their own world.
Which is
very much within the genre of candid photography, isn't it? That kind of documentary sort of approach. The photographer becomes fly on the wall. Moving on. Yes, this is a beautiful portrait.
Yeah, this is Dipora.
And I think, I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt you, but I'm amazed because almost 99.999%, you know them by first name. And I think that is amazing, and that just shows, how you get to know people. I think that's great.
Zipporah, I mean, that's a petrol station. There's nothing really fancy there.
Yeah.
We were just stopping to do petrol, and I noticed, like, she has this very, very nice way of placing her hair. And it was just also about her shirt and the sign, I mean, the red bottles behind and the red signs behind. There was a whole, like, kind of, like blending sort of like colors.
Yes.
And her hair and her face. I mean, I think she still didn't understand why I asked her if I could take pictures of her. Like she was a bit like, what? You want to take a photograph of me? Like, I'm the petrol girl, And I was like, yeah, but I like your hair. And I asked her name. And so Zipporah, she told me, means, it means like beautiful, I think something like beautiful girl or something. So I was like, hey, I was right. And I like when things like this happen. It's a form of reward in a way. I saw the beautiful girl in you. You're a beautiful girl. So.
Yes. Absolutely, definitely. That idea of coincidence, isn't it? The idea of coincidence, that things kind of match up. It's wonderful. I love the look. The hairdo is fantastic, but it's also the color codes, the reds, the greens, the reds, the whites, and how it also actually blends in rather beautifully. Folks, we've got about eight more images to go. So we've gone a bit over time, but I hope you're enjoying this talk, because Anne-Laure, you're giving great amount of detail to actually each one of your images. So that's absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
Yeah, that car. That car is absolutely fantastic. I won the same. It was on a photo shoot I was attending for, like, just, you know, supervising, helping for the girl who was organizing the photo shoot. I was not the photographer. I don't do fashion or beauty shoots. But that was the makeup artist car.
Cool.
And, well, it was obviously very expensive. But, yeah, I just love the whole fur, Louis Vuitton, carpet and the steer wheel leopard fur or something.
Yes, absolutely. It's
very funky, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's the exuberance and the exoticism of it all. OTT, over the top, isn't it? And which makes it wow. Yeah, definitely. Has the wow factor.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. This is a wonderful one for me.
Yeah, this one is, I mean, not my favorite, but one of my favorite. I mean, I don't remember his name of the Rasta man, but yeah, I was having a walk, same in Jamestown, because there's lots of things to look at. And I met this guy during my walk. I continued the walk, and later on the walk, I found him in his shop. I'm not too sure, like, he was repairing some stuff, shoes, I guess. And he was standing in the shop with those ice skate blade, yeah, ice skate blades.
Yep.
Well, you obviously kind of know that there's no ice ring in Ghana. And yeah, just the whole situation, the whole scene was kind of incredible. I mean, you can kind of guess a portrait of Bob Marley behind him. If he could have, like, stand just a little bit on the side, it would have been actually perfect. But same. We had, like, yeah, a bit of a chat. We laughed about the ice skater. I mean, asking, like, where did you get that? He found him, you know, from the secondhand market or something, and just placed him there. But the whole scene and the whole character was kind of incredible.
And who's the guy in the black and white photograph by the boots?
Oh, yeah, that's J.K. Rowling. That's the a previous president of Ghana. What, like 2 or 3 mandates ago?
Yes, he was the army guy. He ran a coup, didn't he?
J.K. Rowling's? I mean, G.J. Sorry, my husband's making me. So I always call him J.K. Rowling, G.G. Rowling. J.K. Rowling is the famous writer of Harry Potter, right? I can't get it right. It's G.G. Rowling, but yeah, it's a previous president still.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he died like a year or a year and a half ago. And it was a real ceremony, like a big, big thing. So it's kind of also very emblematic to have J.G. Rowling here.
Yes, absolutely. It's in a way, it's the incongruous or incongruousness of it all. Look, here we have a comment. Joe Black, ice skating boots in Ghana. Just what for? For fun.
I know. I'm still wondering, Joe.
Absolutely. Cool. Thank you, Joe.
No, that's the mini dress.
Wonderful.
I think it's Christine. Yeah, I was just walking in the streets, going to some friends. And I have a thing for those, funny secondhand clothes market. Like, this is such an unusual pattern. And she's probably the only one in Ghana wearing a Mickey and Minnie Mouse dress. And you can notice also, like, she was holding her, I mean, I kind of direct her this way because I noticed the little boy behind. So I just asked her if she could place her hand on the waist so it would create like a little frame for the boy behind.
Of course.
She was just going outside for lunch from work, you know, and she was like, what? But yeah, same, like, we had this bit of a chat. I explained to her why I was coming to her for a picture, but yeah, we just interacted for, you know, it's only a few minutes, but people are usually happy, you know,
Absolutely. Yes. I love it because the colours are so vibrant. And also the fact that this is pop art meets Disney World or meets Disney, you know. So that is absolutely great. And how that actually works, how the colours, the colour codes actually of work with works with everything else, which is rather
more
subdued.
You even have like the blue bucket on the side, you know. Same, it's a bit of a happy mistakes.
Yes.
It's a bit disturbing in the frame, but at the same time, it's, you know, color talking, it's matching with the dress, so.
Absolutely. Again, it's that coincidence, the serendipity, one of my favorite words. And I think this is what informs a lot of my photographic practice is happy coincidence, serendipity. Cool, moving on.
It's like it's never ending. This is in Zulezu. It's on the western coast. It's a village on stilts. Well, I don't know for how long it's still gonna remain on stilts, but I wanted to have pay a visit. So I mean, it's the same. Like you the picture speaks for itself in terms of trying to understand how these people live, you know, the decay of you know, the village. It's a fisherman village, but, you know, like the government or nobody really, I mean, gives a crap about them. They live on like, these stilts houses. Most of them are like destroyed or completely skewed, falling apart into the lake. And it's just, it was very dramatic day in terms of weather, and the boats, nobody used the boats, and I think in the red, it's like a B&B things, like you can rent and stay over for the night in the red house.
Mm-hmm. Cool. It's interesting again how your work, you often include, it's almost an undertone of social commentary. And I think that's rather interesting, without it being in your face, but there's always that undertone of discreet social commentary, which I think is again quite interesting. Tell us about this one.
Okay, this one was the one echoing to the one we had before with the flags.
Yes.
In Cape Coast, it's same, like behind when you pass the door of no return. I just happened to enter into that scene where these four kids were, you know, bent over the fence, the wall, you know, looking at the beach. And I just noticed the combination of all these colors, all these like sizes and different shirts, dresses and everything. And echoing also with the busyness of the boats behind and the flags, and the busyness of the village and of the town behind.
Absolutely, and, yes. And I think those colours. It's always so interesting to see the colours of the tropics, isn't it, or the semi-tropics? They're so loud and so uninhibited. And vibrant, you know, in your face, which is absolutely wonderful, rather than the somber or dour. It's really kind of a joie de vivre, I think, is the word.
Yeah. Even though the scenery, I mean, the slave castle is just behind. I mean, some people ask me, but where can you see joy in that scene? I mean, obviously there's a heavy sense of past and history, but it's behind. Actually, the castle is behind me. Those kids are looking forward. They're you know, that's when what they're wearing is, for me, symbol of freedom and happiness. So,
absolutely, cool. These are your frames. Tell us about your frames.
Yeah. And I just wanted to give also this like sort of second aspect of the work I do with my photograph. So it was interesting to put the previous picture with the with this frame. This is usually, like, this is batik, which is made here. Most of the time I use batik, because wax is sometimes it's coming from China or from Holland. It's not like specifically made in Ghana. So yeah, I just try to combine, you know, the beauty of these fabrics, because I mean, you can never get fed up in terms of patterns and colors, and it's just the same as photography. So, I mean, during the pandemic, I couldn't really go out as much as before. So I was just playing around with my pictures and yeah, trying to complement them with something, you know, to give it a bit more of a, like a pop feel or. Mm-hmm. So I just figured, I said, yeah, let's try, you know, like local fabrics. And yeah, this is two examples. And I think, yeah, I've put another one. But yeah, this is one of the two I really liked. I mean, obviously the two boys sitting on the beach with the, like, it's a, you know, like very sort of like, it's beige, intense beigey, like wood sort of colors. I mean, it goes with what's going on with the sand and the darkness on their back, because obviously it was like a really, really harsh day. And I applied also like a bit of a filter there with water. I don't know, just for fun sometimes.
Cool, absolutely. No, I think they look great because they have that ethnic feel, and in a way it is very much grounded within the regional culture, the batik, and it's also obviously handmade, made in Ghana. So again, it's buying local, shopping local, which we do here as well. Big thing, particularly in the southwest, across Britain, but certainly across the southwest, Devon and Cornwall. And yeah, that's what it's about. I think it looks, and it's what you said, it's funky, it's different.
Yeah. Funky, pop, fun, you know.
Absolutely. Moving on. Oh yes, this is another example. Yeah, yes, wonderful. It echoes.
Example, yeah. The same, like we were, because here you can actually, you can order or make your own stamps, you know, to do the batik, because it's actually wax. It's a pattern on a stamp that you wax and you print it on your fabric before dyeing it. So this is like specifically made, and I asked specifically for a palm trees because I love palm trees. And this is like from the kiss of the palm trees, like they just embrace each other.
Yes.
And you can really tell on the picture, because it's actually quite a bad picture. But I've been working with someone who embroidered. So, I mean, we've been trying to detour some of the of the palm trees
with an embroidery on the I can see it there.
I mean, that's one of the late things I was trying to experiment, you know, to give it a bit more details and saying just to play around.
Absolutely, looking at different alternatives, definitely.
Yes.
Cool.
And I think this is it.
Cool. Well, thank you very much for listening.
Well,
thank you. Cool. And tell me, just to round off, what's next? What are you working on next? What's your next plan? Next steps?
Well, I'm at the moment trying to build an exhibition with a friend of mine. She's a dancer. And we've been over the last year, you know, doing a lot of pictures, photographs just for fun at the beginning. And after a year, I noticed that I had a lot of pictures of her. And some of them very contemporary, some very humoristic, some very conceptual. And I say, why not trying to combine your art, my art? So we're trying to work, you know, by combining photography and modern contemporary dance. So big plan.
Excellent. Well, it sounds great. I think it sounds great because collaboration is the way forward. Definitely, and I think this is a great way to work. So it's brilliant. Oh, we've got a comment come through from Ingrid. Thank you for the inspiration. Wow, Ingrid, that's a great comment. So excellent. Thank you.
Thank you, Ingrid.
Brilliant. So yeah, that sounds really interesting, that work. So do keep in touch, and yeah, I hope we actually pay us another visit.
Another conversation about
yes, why not? I think that would be an excellent idea. And Laure, thank you so much for your presentation. It's been really great. I've really enjoyed this conversation, and I'm sure that our audience has as well. You take care. Oh, we have another comment. Joe Black. Thank you, Harry and Anne-Laure. Great pictures. See you. Joe, thank you so much for your comment. That's great stuff. Wonderful to know. There you go. That's excellent, excellent feedback. So, cool. Okay.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much, Anne.
Thank you, Harry.
Take care. You have a very good evening. Bye for now. Cheers.
Happy Monday.
Indeed. Good week ahead. Absolutely. Bye for now.
Bye.
So, well, that was a really interesting presentation. I think we got some formidable insight into Anne-Laure's way of working. It's not often the case. You often see actually the photographs themselves, but actually seeing behind the image what actually how the image got there in the first place, the drivers behind it, and the kind of process behind the image. And I think this is what In Conversation is all about. It is looking at process. We see the finished product, of course, which is fantastic, but also looking at the process, how the photographer got there. I think that is also very revealing. Another couple of comments. Jen, thank you both. Inspirational photography as always. Jen, thank you so much for that comment. That's absolutely brilliant. Delighted. And Lucia, thank you, Laure. It has been wonderful to go back to Ghana's people and places. Oh, that's a really good comment, Lucia. Thank you so much. Hope you've enjoyed this evening, and we'll see you the week after next. And you can always join us on YouTube. If you subscribe, you'll actually get a direct link when a new program is up, or you can follow us on Eventbrite, where also you'll actually get notification of any new talks, or you can join the newsletter. So either of those ways. Lucia, thank you, Harry, for hosting this event. You're very welcome. My pleasure. Thank you all for being here this evening. Thank you so much, and look forward to see you next time. You take care now. Have a great week ahead. Bye for now.